So the topic today is building FileMaker server dashboard with Node-RED. And we try to put these two pieces together and make some sense out of it. I'll give you a short introduction about me. My name is Marcel Mouret, French name, but German origins. And I was a computer kid in the 80s. Nowadays, I'm an IT professional with design and development background for more than 30 years now. I started FileMaker with version 3 as a tool and for projects with my clients. Nowadays, I'm a bit a consultant, information architect, and still a developer. And this is my setup for today here to give you this presentation. So welcome. And let's just jump in the topic. So I give you a short recap on part one of yesterday. We started with the Raspi as an introduction to how Node-RED came to me. And the Raspi was the door opener for me. It's a cheap Linux box for only 70 bucks. I bought it later last year. It's a fully equipped PC ready in 3 minutes with Linux on it. And what surprised me most, there was pre-installed software on it, and one of the software was Node-RED. So I knew not that much before when this machine came to my desk, but I've heard something about Node-RED before, that it is a low-code platform and perhaps an alternative to Claris Connect. And so I was a bit curious, what would that be? I clicked that little red icon here on the bottom where the arrow is located. And then a typical Linux terminal opened, and I was a bit hesitated and thought, oh yes, now that comes the Linux part. That's not my turn, I'm a Mac guy. But I was curious enough to click that link with the IP address in the port 1880. What happened next was this workspace here opened up in the browser. And so I thought that could be something, and I played around a bit with it some days and found some tutorials to dig in deeper. We made some sessions on the local FileMaker meetup a few times at the beginning of this year, and there were much interest in it by other developers. So I thought it could even be a good topic here today on the .fmp. And let's show something what we found out. So yesterday, I showed you a bit of the basics. We will do this in a few minutes again to learn something about Node-RED as a platform, what it can do. I showed some flows and some examples what you can do with it. We have had access to HTTP request for accessing cloud APIs. And we saw an integration with FileMaker, and today we will do a bit more about it. To put it in one image, what you saw yesterday, we integrated Node-RED as a platform, and we accessed some cloud services and got some data about real clouds, accessed the weather API. I showed you a bit of IoT hardware integration. There was this light system from Philips, the Hue system with a motion sensor bridge and some light bulbs. And I showed you how to trigger an event with this motion sensor and do something with it in FileMaker. I showed you some dashboards, even mobile dashboard integration with Node-RED. And then we got into the FileMaker part of it and accessed the data API with a Node-RED plugin and made sense of it with some demo files in FileMaker. So just to give you a bit of background of the what the platform is and what it could do, I compiled a few slides here for entry into the topic. What is Node-RED? It is a low-code platform that let you build flows easily in your web browser. And the main part of it is it integrates very easy with IoT and cloud services. And you could even deploy your own APIs. Very simple. We saw that yesterday in less than a minute, we deployed a REST interface and accessed FileMaker wizard. And of course, today we are in the REDpool room again, so that makes sense with Node-RED. So how does Node-RED work? It's all about JSON. Every object flow message is built as a JSON, and we as FileMaker developers are quite familiar with it since some versions. So it's not that a big switch to do something with JSON in Node-RED. Node-RED is a message broker. It's built on top of Node.js. So if you are a bit familiar with Node.js, this is a JavaScript server that is highly parallel, and it works as an autonomous message pipeline. So this is on the groundwork. Node-RED does it all for you without anything is visible. But we saw this web browser interface where you can deploy something, and then Node-RED will take care of it and get generates and compile some messages that are flying around. So there are nodes. So the name Node-RED came from. Nodes are some building blocks. Can do things with it. The nodes trigger and receive messages, and these messages have a payload and some metadata. And the payload is used to send some information from and between all these different things. You can build these messages, you can transform it, you can route it. There are some basic mechanisms for pipelines and triggers. And there are many building blocks for the basic operations, like in FileMaker, where you have this list in the script window with all these single operations. We have a look at it in some minutes. And that's the interesting part. There is a modular plugin architecture with some ready-made bridges to other technologies. And this is the part where the integration takes place. Node-RED itself is this messaging platform. And together with the integrations, you can make some sense out of it. If you receive and send messages between hardware, between services, between software, between your FileMaker server. And this is where the fun part begins. And even JavaScript is part of it. You can code JavaScript. If you need some own logic within the objects, JavaScript is part of the Node.js. So everything is JavaScript and JSON, you can think of. This is a Node-RED website. He has described what Node-RED does. It is a programming tool for wiring together hardware, devices, APIs, and online services in new and interesting ways. This sounds interesting, and we will see that this is not a lie. There's so much in it, and we will be surprised if you see what this integration means in reality. So how does Node-RED integrate? And now we come closer to the topic of today. We will build something with FileMaker server. And first we read something about cloud APIs, REST APIs, and all this stuff, and IoT. This is true, and it's a really big part of Node-RED. But with all these contributions, there are many different technologies that are integrated. And if you think of it in a technical term, what is the mechanics behind it? Node-RED gives you access to the IoT network protocols. There are some different standards now in the industry to access all these devices. If you make home automation or industry automation, or you plug in any hardware device that comes from Apple or from other vendors that has some IoT network protocols, Node-RED handles it for you. You won't see it. You just have a kind of connector, and under the hood, all this network integration is handled for you by Node-RED. It is the main part for IoT, and the other main part for APIs is access to WAN, to web, to cloud APIs. You can send and receive HTTP requests and manipulate them and get data in, out of it. But there's even more, because Node-RED gives you access to the local network. It gives you access to the local file system, and even to the local hardware. And if you think of it not just as a cloud service or IoT integration, this opens up some really interesting possibilities for us if we integrate with FileMaker or with a FileMaker server or any server that we want to handle in the local or remote environment. So let's get practical. We will see some demos now. I think we will spend about 45 minutes or an hour. We have time afterwards to talk about it, to answer some questions or to do some further experiments. First, I will show you some basics, the Node-RED workspace, how to build a dashboard. It's the main part of Node-RED. We connect to FileMaker and see the basic setup, what are the prerequisites to integrate FileMaker with Node-RED. And then we come to the server and the dashboard part. We read the server log files, the FileMaker server log files. We pipe the events to the dashboard we created, and then we pipe it even to a FileMaker file that is hosted on the server. We make this with access via the data API. Then there is a mobile GUI with FileMaker Go. We will even see another mobile dashboard with a native app. And we will see how to handle notifications that when something goes wrong in the server, that Node-RED can send us some messages to our mobile phone when we're on the road or at the customer and not sitting on our server. So this is what happens if you open Node-RED for the first time. You see a blank browser window. There are some panels. On the left side, there is all these colored things, like little Lego objects you can put here on the dashboard and make something out of it. You see on the top, there is this tab interface, which can even be longer. This is where your flows live. When you first start Node-RED, there are only 3 or 5 empty tabs. Here are some flows installed in the background already. On the right side, we see some information panels. There are information about these objects. There is a help section where you can get information about all these and read a bit further to learn something, how this all works. Then we have a debugging window where some messages will show up. We will see this later, what to do about this. And we have this hamburger menu here on the top. And this is very powerful because here you can import and export flows, and you can even load new models. And we have a look at this in a minute. At first, I will show you how to do basic things now. You build a little flow. We have an object here that is a timestamp trigger. We have another object here that is kind of a message output. We can pipe them together. I draw a line here with the mouse and can drag them around. And the obvious thing you see here first are the two blue bullets. It's not that obvious what that means, but if you learn how to use Node-RED, you learn very early that nothing can happen if there's a blue pill on this object, because it is only in the editor and it is not compiled already. So there's a big red deploy button here on the top right side. If I press it, there comes some message. Okay, there might be something wrong here. I try to deploy it nevertheless. So the blue bullets are gone. It was compiled, and I can press a trigger button, and now some message is received here in this right window pane. So let's have a look. I can double click this object. There's a property pane with some change. Here is the timestamp.
Okay, we are in the presentation again. We try to assign a function to our value. So we just multiply this value by 10 and return the new message. I put it to the output, clear the pane, deploy it. And if we trigger the button, we expect something to happen here. So we got this 2 multiplied by the function with 10, and the result is 20. Something happened. And this is all how Node-RED is built. You have all these blocks. You can wire them together. You can you have different types of blocks here that make basic operations. And we will see that there are a lot of it. We have here network in and out, HTTP request, and HTTP parser even to parse website data. We have some things for serial connections. If you have other hardware connections, you can do TCP connectors. There are SSH clients to interact with the underlying operating system. There are some buffer elements here, some parsers for common data formats. And there's a lot you can do with all this. And to make some sense of it, there are further details here. And it's a lot of learn somehow. Depends on what you plan to do. But if you keep it simple and depend on some basic operations, it is possible to make some steps into without too much headache. And so we saw this, how this flow works, and what these objects are, that we could deploy it and compile it, and Node-RED will run them. And there's a bit more here on this palette menu. We can export all this. And what we see here is all is JSON. The flow that we just defined here, we can make this pretty print every information about the blocks, about the functions and the messages inside of it, and the JavaScript code we embedded, everything is here in a JSON object. And we could copy this to our clipboard or download it to file and deploy it somewhere else. And this is the basic principle how our source code is generated. And there are even some sophisticated methods to put this automatically into a Git repository with version controlling and deployment to other server systems. There's a lot of infrastructure around it, but we keep it simple for today and just try to make some things work here in our local machine. So another important part of this whole concept is the palette with the plugins. You see here are some plugins already installed. And here is an installer search window, a bit like Google. It presents not much, but a blinking cursor and a number. And the number means there are 3,300 plugins available. That's a lot. It's quite not that much that MBS plugin offers us in the FileMaker world, but 3,000 is a lot if you think of other platforms like Claris Connect, where we only have 56 connectors at this moment. This is a hell lot more here. And you could type anything in and receive a result. And here are over 40 functions in just one plugin. And so all these plugins have on the Node-RED website a description what you can do with it. This is an image editor, perhaps. Here are some screenshots what you can do and how these single items interact with each other. There are some installation lines, but you don't have to know all this. You can just return to your palette and say, okay, install this. And then in the background, it will start an NPM request. NPM is Java, Node.js contribution server. I can't explain it so good. It means if you install it, it loads some source code for this module out of the website from a web repository and puts it on your local machine. And this all happens in the background on the terminal. You don't see it. You just get a message that everything worked. So here are some bouncing bars, and a few seconds later, depends where the installation will be ready. You can view the log, but normally you just click the button and the plugin is here. So we have a look on other things. We talked about APIs and cloud. So you can imagine anything, there will be a plugin for anything someone has built before. And we can even type in FileMaker here and say, see that there is a FileMaker contribution that sounds interesting. We have a look at it. And you see it's really sophisticated, very much information here, a whole table of contents and many pages of information, how this all works and what the elements are for. And you see a preview here of the type of the elements. So we have some basic operations to interact with the FileMaker data API. And the interesting thing is, this is not by FileMaker nor by Node-RED, but from a guy, Louis de la Parra. He is a FileMaker developer like we are. And he presented this tool a few years ago on the FileMaker DevCon. And he really put much work in it to make it easy for us. We just have to click a button here to install it. And we have a pre-created bridge to interact with the FileMaker data API. So let's go get back to our work pane here. We saw all these node elements. We can look for the FileMaker thing. Here is the FileMaker. Down. Okay, and we have all these objects here installed, and we just drag it in. We can double click. We get some properties, and the property here is to connect to a data API on a server. So we can click this little edit button and can give it a server address, a database name, an account name, and an account password. And then the connection will be established in the background. So I did it before. So we have this Linux box here as a virtual machine running in the background on my machine. I can just select it. We connect it to the output, deploy it, and look what it does. You see, oh, we need a trigger to it. So it would not fire from alone. We put a trigger in front of it. And this sounds like product info, something will be displayed. So we got an answer from the FileMaker data API. It says what its name is, the version number, and the build date. And we see just by dragging in some colored object, we made a connection to the FileMaker server. So how does it work in the background? I open the Linux box here. I have a virtual machine with some CentOS and the Linux version of Clarus FileMaker server. We can log in to the dashboard here, and we see that are some settings activated. The FileMaker data API has a blue button here. It is active. This is the part from the server to allow the communication, but there are some more prerequisites. You have to have an SSL certificate, and it's not possible to take the standard certificate that is delivered with the FileMaker server, but you need to install a new one. And this is a bit tricky part, but I managed to do it in about 15 minutes. I went to SnapNames. They have for $5 a 2-year certificate. You can authenticate it by email address. So a few minutes later, you get this certificate that you can install on your local machine. And you see this domain name here, fms.myname.de. And FMS is just a fake subdomain. I just got into the host file of my machine and said, if this subdomain is addressed, it will take the IP address of my machine. So I didn't even needed a DNS server running. I just installed this certificate with a fake subdomain name that is identical with my IP address of the server. And so all prerequisites are done. And on the other hand, we have this dialog here to manage the connection. Here is the name of my server again. I have a connection to a test data API database we will see in a minute. And here comes another important part. If I open the database, so I go to the host. Here's my Linux machine again. We see some files on it. And here you see the green lock. The padlock is on because we installed a proper certificate. And if I log in, we got this test file here. And what is important to access this file from Node-RED is the security settings, where you can set up own account for the data API, give it a name and a password. And so you have the credentials that you put in here. Here is the account name and the password, and everything is complete. So we have the address, we have the name of the database, we have the name of the account, and now Node-RED with this plugin knows how to speak with FileMaker on the data API. That is a basic thing to know about. So we can make a connection to FileMaker and do some things. We make sense of it a bit later, but first I would like to show you some basics about the Node-RED dashboards, because we want to build a dashboard today. And we are lucky because there is a dashboard mode in Node-RED integrated. I'm not sure if it's part of the main installation or if it's a plugin for itself. I saw there are different plugins you can install for other types of dashboards. Here, you can open it in another tab, and I have predefined with, we saw this weather thing yesterday, and yesterday we added a dashboard for the weather of Berlin. I try to drag it out here to another window that we can see what happens. So here's our dashboard, and here's our flow for the weather. And we have here three simple flows that fires a trigger, read some HTTP data, get some values out of the response, and put it on the dashboard item. So if I open this item, this is this first, the yellow one here. I can define some basic properties. We can have a gauche or a donut. Change this to gauche again, and you can give it a name. This is broken is the name of a mountain here in the Harz Mountain area. We can here do some range and define some colors. We say it should go deep red if it's more than 20 degrees, and we deploy it, and now that something should happen. So the dashboard gets some message in the background and refreshes itself. So we have a new type of display here. We have a new value of 20. We had 30 before, so the pointer is more to the right here. And can even change here the Berlin weather again. Make it gauche again, deploy it, and something should happen here again. So here's the Berlin weather. Can show you some other interesting things to give you an idea what these dashboards can look like. We have other kinds of display forms. We can have images, we can have tables and some kind of graphs that are interactive, and you can do something here with the mouse on the data. We can have table data that could be sorted, and you can access any of these items and make some properties, how big it is, how many columns you need. You can change the layout. There's a symbol you can assign, some labels. There are all kinds of controls to make sense out of this dashboard thing. So just to give you an idea what it would look like. And so we have learned now in some minutes that Node-RED gives us a possibility to define some flows and send messages around. We can talk to FileMaker server with the data API, and we can build some dashboards. And so at one of our local FileMaker meetings here in the region, we sat together with some guys and talked about the possibilities. And someone said, I see Holger is here today. Hi, Holger. I think it was your idea to build a server dashboard. And so we went on and tried something. And first steps were not that lucky. We had to learn some things and changed our concept how to do this a few times, because the main question was, how can we access the interesting data from the FileMaker server to get it into Node-RED? And so we had different ideas about it, and the most easy way would be if both of the services are running on the same machine. First, we tried to access by SSH tunnel to build a data pipeline on the network to access the other server machine. But finally, what I did here is I installed a fresh Linux server with FileMaker server for Linux on it, and on the same machine I installed this Node-RED server, and it's just a service on the terminal you can start, and then you can get a little message here that it is running, and to do all this it needs only 20 minutes. And I have prepared some quick start guides for you with all these links how to do it. There is this nice installation text here from Christian from MBS. He published this on the FM Soup, and I did not know much about Linux, but with his tutorial here, there are many pictures in it and some basic guides to what to do. I made this step by step, and 15 minutes later, I had my own virtual machine with a FileMaker server for Linux running on it. I told you about the SSL certificate thing, and I managed to put everything together I needed in about 20 minutes. The other thing is Node-RED itself. Yesterday, I showed you the Node-RED that was pre-installed on my Raspberry machine. And if you need a fresh install, there's on the Node-RED Git repository for every major operating system, there are some predefined commands that you can just copy and run on your terminal, and everything happens automatically. You don't have to do all these steps that are needed to get the right version, to get the right dependency with the NPM service and the Node.js service. You can just copy such a line for your Linux, and it runs, and a few minutes later you have a running version with the latest installment here. And this is the easy way, and there are some tutorials on the web as well. You can find it, just Google the name of your OS and your machine, and you will get some tutorials or some hints in the Node-RED forum, and it's really easy to make this happen for yourself. So this is what I did to bring this two pieces together, because we were interested in information of the FileMaker server that would not be easy to get via the data API. because when the server crashes, the FileMaker server or something goes wrong, how would you be able to communicate? So we thought a bit deeper and said it would be good if we had a possibility to read the log files. And as we saw in the beginning, on the first slides, Node-RED is able to access the local file system. And so we have this FileMaker server folders here, and there's a log folder, and here are the access log, event log, data API log, whatever we would like. And so it's really easy. If we are on the same machine with our Node-RED, there might be some node to give us access to these paths. We know these paths, where the log files are, and why not try to read them? So we go back to our Node-RED workspace, and we switch to another machine here. So, okay, here we are. This is a prepared result. And as you see here, there are some of these log file paths we just saw it here in the Linux windows. And there is a tail node. And I did not know what that meant before, but there's a Unix or Linux command tail. And that means it gives you the last part that changed of a text file. And it sounds interesting because the other thing would be to read the whole file, but then you would need to examine for yourself what changed since you read it the last time. And so this tail node gives us the option to let our operating system do this work and just give it a file name with a path in it and say, okay, we need something back. We want text as strings, or we want a binary buffer. Could make sense in another environment, but we would like to have text. And we can even do a regular expression here, how to split this text. And we will say if there is any of return on new line, so give us what it is in between. And we will try to see what this makes. I have a demo here on top of it. I just push the trigger button and something happens. Oh, that's a lot, because I did this for the first time now, and it gave us all what is in this log file, what have changed since the last time, and it seems to be a lot. What we can also see here is that this is just an array of strings. Here's the string with the number 129, and then comes 130, and then there's a string in it. And if you know the format of this FileMaker log file, you will see the timestamp and these codes here, and the address, and a message, and an IP. That is what normally goes into a line of the FileMaker server log file. So we have a quite easy, press it again, and now, okay, it reads something again. But the question is now, how could we handle all this information? And so we would need some kind of buffer to aggregate this and put it out step by step so that we could do something with it in a normal order. And so I made some investigations here. What can we do? And I found a kind of buffer array node. It's a basic operation in Node-RED. And this buffer just could give it a name and a length. And it collects some messages and give you every 10 messages a block of an array to the next item. So, and what I have built here is a kind of a split for this line, because we have split values here with CSV format. And I put in a bit of JavaScript code to get this whole message to make an empty array. Then I have a for loop to go through this message that I received. And then I do a split operation on the strings I receive and divide it into single pieces. The first column is the timestamp, then comes the type, code, a domain name, and the text. So this is what the FileMaker server normally will display us in the log file. And we split it into single pieces and then push it into an array and make here a JSON object out of it. So we are only interested in three information: the timestamp, the code, and the text. We make an array of JSON objects, put it back to the payload, and give it a title as some metadata also in the JSON, and return this message. And what it does is it puts this on a dashboard, and the dashboard item here is a table node. The table node receives some events. We have three columns here for the timestamp, the code, and the text. And we can assign a property here. And what it means, it gets a message payload, and one property of the payload array has a name timestamp. It's a kind of identifier here. And so it will grab out this the piece of data and put it in a dashboard table for us. And so we have a look how this will play out. This is our dashboard I prepared here. We have three input nodes here with event log, the access log, and the FN data API log. We put it in a buffer, 10 messages in a block. Then we split it by columns, and we put the columns into a table. And that is what you see on the right side here. We have three blocks, the events, the access, and the data API log. We have the three columns here, the time, the code, and the text. And we have some kind of table that displays all these values that we collected here in the array. So this is just static. We need to do something here. I will try to trigger some events. I close this database. So the FileMaker server will write something to its log file, and we will see if something happens here. Okay, it was not that visible so much. The last item of this access column here changed the value. There's a new timestamp in it. 7050 is our time right now. And the message says client Marcel Mourier has closed the connection. This is German here, schließt eine Datenbank. Okay. So we saw it was really real time. I just did something out of the scope of Node-RED. The server does something in the background. He writes a log file, and but Node-RED had a kind of live mode to examine what is in the file and reacts very quickly to grab this change and put it on the dashboard. I open this file again, another one here, and we expect something to happen. In that moment, I press the connect button here. So have a look at this table here on the middle. That should happen something. And zack, we see the two new codes with two new timestamps. And here is a message that I have opened a new connection, and we see it on our dashboard. And the question is, could we do something more with it? Because dashboard is nice, but it would be even nicer if we can see our dashboard if we're not sitting in front of our server. So there is a nice possibility here. And this is a native client for Node-RED, a dashboard client. I show you the website first. This is a small app. It's a few bucks. You can download it from the App Store or from the Google Play Store. And what it does is it connects to a Node-RED server instance and receive all these messages that we saw here in the dashboard window, and you could just download it, install it on this iPhone and iPad version, and I will just show it how it looks. I have to switch to Reactor and get my iPhone on the screen. So this is what it looks like. There are some connections. You can add another instance here. So you can control multiple Node-RED servers. I installed my local machine here. And here are our dashboards. We can switch to these different displays. We had this weather kind of thing here. The Berlin weather, and so you can scroll in it, you can click on it, you can swipe between the different views, and so we have some possibility to display our data here on a mobile device. And if you manage to give access from outside your network, you can even do this from the road to see if there's something happening. So what else can we do? We have access to the data API we saw. So perhaps it would be nice to get our log files from the FileMaker server and put it into a FileMaker database. And we saw that there are some building blocks here to access the data API. And the data API gave us possibility to create records. So the same thing we saw before on the other machine, we give it a name of a server. We define a layout where this data should be sent to. We get our payload from the nodes here in our flow. We can even trigger some script, but we won't here in this case. And we get an output back from the data API with some information about what was created. So I've prepared this database here already. There's just a table in it. You can switch here to table view, and you will see that here is the same data in it as on our dashboard. I try to open a new connection. I will just delete all this data here, that we see if something changes. Open another database from the same server. And here is our message that something happened. So I will close this again. Next message comes here, the same message on our dashboard. And we can trigger a local backup perhaps on the machine. Go to the backup tab, it's here. Okay, I click the button and there should be written something to the server log file. Here are all the new entries. It says it started a new backup script with a name, how many databases, that it was ready, and that the next timestamp here for the next backup was planned on the server. Same thing here on our dashboard. We have the same messages here, and if we look on our iOS client, we will see the same. So let's make a short recap what happened so far. We have this log files here on our server and a tail node that read the differences. We get these differences in our array buffer, built an array of 10 items. We split the lines of the log file into columns and put the columns into a JSON object with three values. And then we route the result of it to the dashboard table. And here we read the same log file again. Now we split it by one because we want one new entry here for each line. We make the split again. This time we get five items here out of the columns. We take the timestamp, the type, the code as a number, the domain name and the event name. We put all these together in an array, in a JSON array. Then we say, put this JSON array to a split node, and the split node transformed this in a format that our create data entry for the FileMaker data API could understand. And so every time something in the log file changes, several messages are sent. Some messages are going to the dashboard, and at the same time, the messages coming via the data API to back to the server in a separate table. Was it clear so far? Are there any questions at this time? Okay, I can't hear anything, but I think no one is speaking except me.
No questions.
Okay, one last thing we have here. There is another layout in this database, and the idea behind it is that we could put it onto an iOS device with FileMaker Go on it. I just start my iPhone again and bring this on the presentation screen. Here we are. So I put this aside and try to trigger something on the server again. We just do another backup. And we will see on the iOS client, here are the new entries coming in with the new timestamps. And the idea is to have some filter options here on top of it. We can press the backup button and only get the backup events, or we can press a client button and only get the client events. And you can imagine something that makes sense for your use case. And so we built with very little ingredients some useful possibility to monitor what's happening on our FileMaker server. And these are only some examples. You can imagine even more, because when it comes to notifications or something, some values are exceeded, you define some threshold and a value will go out of range, something could happen. And I will show it to you with another example. We switch back to our first server, because there is a ready-made example for a similar thing we have here. A dashboard for a web server that is running customized shop software. This is the example we saw before. And what happens here is there is some cron jobs on the web server. It's a Linux system, and it writes out some statistics every hour or so. And there's a cron job that collects all these images that are generated by the statistic tool and put it via an SSH tunnel to my local machine in a defined folder with defined names and timestamps. Then we get some values out of an SQL database with even a cron job. There's an SQL command that gets the size of the cache table this is here, this is session size, sorry, gets the session size. Another cron job collects the number of files in the cache folder, and then we make a call to the server log file to find out how many access via HTTP are made in a range of a day. And we see here happening some interesting things. The graph is rising, and this is because Google Crawler comes along, and the shop has some 60,000 pages, and Google Server will make a lot of traffic here to index all these pages. And we have even a table here, and what the cron job script behind the scenes makes, it takes all these IP addresses and asks who is service in the web to identify which crawler is coming along, or if it's sometimes there is a Chinese a name here with some things that looks a bit strange, and then you know, okay, there might be some evil crawler that puts a lot of traffic on your website, and you want to put it on a blacklist or something like that. The idea here is to collect many values and send them in a local folder where Node-RED can access this. And what we have here is a kind of alarm trigger. We have done a similar thing here. We have a directory where we get all these log files. There's a filter on it because every file has a timestamp in it. So we filter out this timestamp and collect all these files we can get. If we have this file, we pass the file data with a little JavaScript and convert the timestamps and the values in a JSON object that we could make sense of. And then we put it onto a graph element here on our dashboard. And the dashboard graph element has some intelligence for itself. It just gets an array of values and knows what to do with it. If there are timestamps in it, you can define a number of days or weeks or seconds or minutes or what else, or a number of points that should be displayed. And you have a label here in the date format. You can put some colors in, and you can define how this interactive element should behave. And we put the same data that we have just generated here and get not the last X logs, but the last one log, split it into one message with a predefined length. And now we get our data. And when our data is ready, we have a switch node element here. This gets the last Y. This is the last value here in the graph. And we have a comparison selector here. We compare it to identical or not identical or less or greater or whatever. And we say here, if it's greater than 250,000, in this file, it's the number of cache items here, then there should happen something. Then this should route to the output. Otherwise, there will happen nothing. If we trigger the output, we create a new object here. We combine a text for the alarm message. We say, okay, cache size, and we get our object value we just created before, put an object name on it, put this alarm message into our payload. And here is something interesting. Here is a prol node. A prol, someone of you might know it, is a kind of notification service. It has an own website. I could just recommend it. It could be a topic of another session, perhaps. I think someone made this before some years ago here in .fmp in Berlin. He showed some integration from prol with FileMaker. You can imagine it like sending an SMS, but there is an API service here behind this website, and you can just get an API key here. It does not cost any money. You will have 1,000 messages for free or something like that. And if you got this API key, you can integrate in different apps or platforms. And There's even a mobile app for it, so you can receive these messages on your iPhone. And the idea here is there's for sure a plugin for Node-RED that makes sense of it. So we can look here in our plugin, Google search machine. If we type in Prol, we see there is a contribution for sending messages to the Prol service. So that makes it very easy, because all we need is our API key, and that's it. It just takes the message object and sends it to the Prol service. And so we had our switch here to define when should the trigger fire. If the value goes up 250,000, then make an alarm string and send the alarm string to the Prol service with our API key. I can just show you how this looks like on my mobile phone. And I'm really happy with this, because when I'm on the road or not in my office, I get some messages all day long and could see if our databases or servers or shop system is healthy, or if something happens that is have to be looked at. And I've even sending Prol messages from my batch actions inside my FileMaker solution. It's very flexible to do many things with it. So here we have a kind of alarm. We see here today, an hour ago, there was alarm about these hits we saw in this table. And these hits were above a predefined value of, I think, 50,000 is the threshold. And we are here by 60,000. So it grabs the name from the IP whois service, put it in a message here together with the hit number and the IP address, and sends me a message that perhaps there is something going on and I should have a look at it. So this I showed you now this web server thing, because after I understood what we can do with it with Node-RED, I left this FileMaker server thing a bit at side, because we have other mechanisms to monitor this at this time. But it showed me the potential, what different things we can do with it. And I think if we take this as a starting point, we can imagine to develop it a bit further. If we come back to our dashboard here, to monitor our FileMaker server, there could be many interesting things that go beyond listing the log files. FileMaker server itself do not give us practical way to monitor the log files. So it was the first idea to make it accessible here. We have this protocol activity here in Germany, these logs. You have to download it every time, and you have to drop it to your local machine, and you have to open a text editor and have to log in at it. And if something happens 5 minutes ago, you have to do it again. And so this is very impractical, what FileMaker offers here. And so this is a step further to get this in real time without downloading and opening a log file. We get this in real time, not only to our dashboard, we get it to a database, we can send notifications. And now your creativity is asked, what else would be nice to do? And perhaps we can read some hardware specs from the machine, if it has enough RAM, or if the hard disk has some, or the network has some issues. So all this can be monitored with an appropriate node. There are a hardware dependent node where you can get these metrics. And we could even think about accessing the admin API, because FileMaker server now offers us possibility to get an REST API to read all these connections, how many users, how many licenses are left. And even those information could be aggregated and put together on a dashboard. You could imagine an alarm event if some timings are bad, or too many connections are made, or your license pool is running low. It's up to us now to do something with it and to spin our creativity to develop this idea further. And I think Node-RED could be a good starting point here. And I prepared all these things you saw here as a demo, as a package for you. There's a zip file with this demo file in it, with all this JSON code for Node-RED, with all the passwords and the description, how to deploy it. I prepared a quick start guide for you, where you can see the download links to install Node-RED to your local machine, how to install the Linux server and everything else you need. And so if we come back to the presentation now, just three or more slides and we are ready here so far and can answer some questions.
Do you hear me? Hello?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
So why is Node-RED great for this? We saw
Marcel doesn't hear us. So.
Is it kind of quick start? You will invest 1 or 2 days to understand the basic principles, to read or view some tutorials, to make some own experiments. It has no fees on it. It runs on any platform. And there's a huge community, and that cannot be underestimated because I was really surprised how much is happening in this community. It is driven by home automation and crazy projects people are doing with Node-RED. And what really surprised me, that are not only hardcore developers like us, that are ordinary people. They build some gardening infrastructure with to pump the water into their flowers or what else on this Raspberry platform. And Node-RED is a really driver in this industry of IoT and hardware integration. And there are tons of tutorials and documents on the web. You can spend hours to watch really high level samples that other people made. And I really was not into Linux or Node-RED or anything before. I started at the beginning of this year and made a few sessions to learn something about it. And after 2 or 3 weeks, I was able to build all these things you saw today. So there's a huge collection of any kind of integration plugins, even for FileMaker, as we saw, and it's an ideal platform to learn low code. Claris gave us low code in the form of Claris Connect. It's an interesting platform as well, but I think Node-RED is a lower hurdle for us to jump over. You can refer to our to my yesterday's presentation. There are some reasons for this, and there are some comparisons in the presentation files. You can download them from the file section here. And so this could be a starting point. I compiled this quick start guide. You can download it. There are many links in it, tutorials for the Node-RED thing and the Raspberry thing. And you can get the sample files from yesterday for building an own REST API to FileMaker, and the sample files of today to build this dashboard. And you find here these items here on the bottom side are clickable. There is a link in it to my Dropbox and to my blog. And I try to collect and develop this idea a bit further. So there's many interesting stuff inside already you can download. And I would call you for a challenge today that we develop this idea further. Let's improve this dashboard idea. It's your turn to learn Node-RED, to exchange ideas in local meetups, and at the next conference, we share our results and see if we make possible something really exciting, because Node-RED is like a big playground for crazy ideas, and it could be a good challenge for all of us to do something with it. So if you want to connect me, there are some links in the slides. I have a blog, I have 2 accounts on Twitter where I'm active relative often. This first account is my personal account, and the second, Dateimacher, is a German word for FileMaker. And so there I collect FileMaker related things. I'm on LinkedIn. I have some other social media accounts here as well. So we get in contact when the conference is over and make something out of this. I will say thank you. And now, if you like, we can do some Q&A and I answer your questions.